a very easy situation to operate. You just push the buttons in right here on the two sides, the two little buttons. And all you do is push them in, and that will release it. And what, right here, push the button in, that releases it. And then after you let go, it locks firmly in place. So really, you're all set. And this is tough.
It is.
Listen, give you an example. Say you have a, you know, you have to get up on the wall, high ceiling, vault
right.
to ceiling. Hey, listen, just walk right up. And I tell you, it's very safe, it's durable, and
Carol,
it's lightweight.
You're scaring me.
So really,
see, wow.
Now it's locked in place, okay? So really, you say,
oh God, Harold, are you okay?
Actually, I didn't have it locked. You have to lock it. Once you lock it, you're okay. But it is very safe to operate. So, continue to call for it.
All righty. Well, Harold.
Robert Fulton, credited with the invention of the first steamboat. Robert Fulton was born at the beginning of the American Revolution on a farm in Little Britain, Pennsylvania. Fulton decided to stay and work in Philadelphia as an artist, drawing landscapes and portraits, and also drew the plans and designs for houses and machinery. After several years, when he was 23 years old, he decided to visit Europe. In 1797, he went to Paris and studied French and German mathematics and chemistry. Fulton was not the inventor of the first steamboat, but rather the inventor of the first practical and efficient steamboat. The person credited with the original invention of the steamboat was John Fitch, and included a steam engine driven by several mounted oars and could carry up to 30 passengers. His boats were successful, but he didn't pay attention to the construction and operating costs. Overall, it was too expensive and the economic benefits of steam navigation too few. Fulton was able to take Fitch's design and improve it to make it profitable. Fulton's first successful steamboat was the Clermont. As well as making the first profitable steamboat, Fulton also designed the first working submarine, the Nautilus. While living in France, he later switched his loyalties and moved to Britain, where he designed the world's first modern torpedoes. After the decisive Battle of Trafalgar, however, Fulton's naval inventions were no longer needed, and he was largely ignored. Later, he married and moved back to America.
Is that good?
I think that's good.
Samuel F.B. Morse was born on April 27, 1791, in Charleston, Massachusetts. He was raised by Jedediah Morse and Anne Finley Breeze. He believed in having a strong central government and supported in having an alliance with Britain. He started out being a well-known American painter and eventually became the inventor of the telegraph and Morse code. While in D.C. doing a painting, he received word that his wife was ill, and immediately traveled to New Haven to see her, but was too late. She had already died. This is why he started on the invention of the telegraph, a way of communicating quickly over long distances. With the help of Charles Thomas Blackman, who studied in electromagnetism, Morse developed the concept of the single-wire telegraph. Professor Leonard Gale, who taught chemistry, also helped introduce extra relays of a message and allowed it to travel longer distances than ever. In time, the Morse code was the primary language of telegraphy in the world. As well as inventing the telegraph, he was also a leader in the anti-Catholic and anti-immigration movement in the mid-19th century. He died April 2nd, 1872.
Still going?
Yes.